Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Kenneth V. Santagata Memorial Lecture for the spring semester. I'm Davis Robinson from the Department of Theater and Dance. This lectureship was conceptualized by Ken Santagata, a member of the Bowdoin class of 1973, to bring bold speakers with fresh ideas to campus. Ken Santagata, who was himself a bold and unorthodox thinker, tragically died of Hodgkin's disease only 8 years after his Bowdoin graduation, and his parents established this lecture series in his honor. One of Ken's close friends and classmates, Alan Christenfeld, is here tonight, and I'd like to recognize him, Alan. Alan, you here? Thank you. And your family for coming up to Brunswick for this important event. Our speaker tonight is Oskar Eustis, who is the artistic director of the Public Theater in New York City and a professor of dramatic writing and arts and public policy at New York University. Prior to joining the Public Theater in 2005, Mr. Eustis served as artistic director of the Trinity Repertory Company in Providence, Rhode Island, associate artistic director at the Mark Taper Forum in Los Angeles, and resident director, dramaturg, and then artistic director at the Eureka Theatre Company in San Francisco. Mr. Eustis has also been a professor at UCLA, Middlebury College, and Brown University. Oskar Eustis is, to put it succinctly, a giant in the American theater. He is best known for having produced the original productions of Hamilton and Fun Home before they became legendary on Broadway, and for commissioning and directing the original production of Angels in America. He is also well known for directing and producing Shakespeare all across the country, including award-winning productions in San Francisco and on Broadway, and in New York's famous Shakespeare in the Park series. Less known is that Mr. Eustis, can you tell I'm reading? Okay. Also directs Shakespeare plays in some of our nation's bleakest prisons, and that he continues to teach a theater class at a high school in Brooklyn. To understand Mr. Eustis's influence, you need to first understand the reach of the Public Theater. That organization actually runs 5 theaters, a nightclub, and an emerging writers group, and is essentially an incubator for some of the brightest and most innovative theatrical talent in the country, in the world. Productions first given life at the Public Theater are now thriving throughout Broadway, off-Broadway, and in theaters and workshops across the country. Lynn Nottage's Sweat just opened. Theater plug, go check it out. And Mr. Eustis has used this influential position to democratize American theater and push the envelope of what topics are appropriate for modern audiences. Hamilton and Fun Home are great examples of this. One is a revolutionary hip-hop exploration of the Founding Fathers, and the other is an intimate musical about a lesbian cartoonist whose gay father committed suicide. As Mr. Eustis told Vogue magazine a year ago, we're taking artists we believe in and letting their visions become as individual as they are. This approach has had and continues to have an extraordinary impact on the vibrancy and originality of American theater and on all of us who are touched by it. So, we are delighted to have with us here at Bowdoin tonight one of the most singularly influential, creative, and visionary theater producers of our generation. Please join me in welcoming Oskar Eustis.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you. That please. That sounds like a guy I'd love to meet. But instead, we get me tonight. I'm going to talk for a while, probably show you a brief video clip, and then open it up for questions, answers, manifestos, and disagreement, so just we can make sure that the conversation is going where you're most interested in going. But it's, I think, my job to start it out. So let me, I'm going to do sort of 3 snapshots of some of the issues that I think are facing us right now in the American theater. But when I say the American theater, I really mean the issues that are facing us in America. And the first, I want to draw your attention to, you know, a little sort of, I don't know if I'd call it a point of pride, but a point of acknowledgement that our president asked me to apologize to him. The vice president-elect came to see Hamilton. Some of you will have heard about this. And Brandon Victor Dixon made a statement from the stage to the vice president about how he and many members of the cast felt worried about the coming administration and felt unsafe and were hoping that there would be some gesture to make them feel more safe. The president was very upset about this, and the president-elect, not the vice president, Vice President Pence, handled it with great dignity and grace. He actually said to his son, when he came into the theater, a considerable percentage of the audience booed, and he turned to his son and said, "Son, that's the sound of democracy," which, you know, that's after my own heart. But because of what President-elect Trump tweeted about us, there became a movement to boycott Hamilton. And this movement was, of course, on the internet. And it really got a lot of signatures. A couple of 100,000 people signed within 48 hours to boycott Hamilton. Now, here's the real issue, though. You think about that for a second. Those 200,000 people who signed a petition to boycott Hamilton were never going to see Hamilton. They couldn't afford a ticket. It wasn't coming to a town near them. And if it had, they didn't have the connections to get the in to get a seat. So really, you look at that and you go, that extraordinary move to boycott our show was really a response to the fact the show had already boycotted those people. The show was already structured in a way that those people were not invited to the table. They were not invited to be part of it. Second snapshot. If somebody would have presented to me, before I thought of this, the electoral map of the United States, the red and the blue map, and just shoved it in front of my nose and said, "All the blue areas mark where the major nonprofit theaters in the United States are," I would have looked at it and gone, "Yeah, that's right." In other words, all of the major nonprofit theaters in this country are in sections that went blue, that vote Democratic. Again, you can explain it one way or you can explain it another way. That just like the economy having turned its back on a considerable section of the country, just as the educational system has turned its back on a considerable section of the country, just as technology has turned its back, culture has turned its back. Again, we essentially have not made it our responsibility to speak to a significant percentage of the country. And if we didn't think it was significant, we wouldn't have been so upset on November 8th, because it turned out to be very significant. That's something that I feel as a cultural worker, and not, you know, I'm broader than just a theater, cultural, is just terribly important for us to grasp, for us to actually look at and take seriously. Because the theater, of course, is fundamentally democratic, and I mean small d democratic. I do not mean donkeys. I mean a democratic medium. It's founded to be a democracy. As a matter of fact, one of the few things that we know about the origins of the theater is that it was founded in the same city, in the same decade, as democracy was founded. Now, Athenian democracy was terribly problematic, and by the way, I'm a theater practitioner, so I claim exemption from all your classics professors. But what I'm saying is, nonetheless, I tell stories, right? This is a good story, I'm telling you. And it's got a lot of truth to it, just like Henry V. That in the Athenian democracy was very problematic. It obviously didn't include women. It was a slave society. Nobody had any power unless they owned property. We've got much to criticize and dislike, and we certainly wouldn't want to adopt Athenian democracy. But the essential idea that power flowed from below to above, that those who ruled, ruled by the consent of the governed, not the other way around, was born there. And is it a coincidence that in that same decade, what we call drama was born? Now, the origins of drama, of course, are not completely precise, but let me tell you a story about it that I think is pretty accurate. What we know about the Festival of Dionysius is it was a religious festival, 3 days in Athens. Most of the population came. Actually, dispute about whether women came, but I'm not going to get into that because somebody will correct me, and then I'll get really self-conscious, and then I won't keep going. So, 3-day festival in which storytelling was part of the festival. So we know that stories were told. And then at some point in that decade, legend has it, somebody named Thespis thought, what if instead of a storyteller speaking to you and telling you a story, what if that storyteller pivoted 90 degrees to the left and spoke to somebody else on stage. And that act actually changes everything about what's happening. Because let's look at just the status relationship. Right now, I'm talking to you guys, right? I'm the expert, I have the authority, you're sitting back, you're taking what I receive, or taking what I give you, you're receiving what I give you. You may disagree, but you're being quiet and polite about it. You may hate what I'm saying, you may be bored, but nonetheless, you are passively receiving from an authority what the truth is. Now, as soon as somebody turns and talks to somebody else on stage, as soon as dialogue is invented, look what happens, what gets destabilized. First of all, you're saying, there isn't one person who has the authority because there are two people up there and they're disagreeing with each other, or the scene wouldn't be very interesting. They're actually arguing with one another. So right there, you're saying the truth does not rest in any person. Truth rests in the conflict between different points of view. And we all know enough about playwriting to know that if it's not a good play if one person is right and one person is wrong. What happens is plays mark how people change, and they change by interacting with each other. And if you don't believe that, you don't really believe in democracy. You may put up with democracy. You might tolerate it because you can't think of a better way to do it, or you don't have enough power to force everybody to do what you want to do, but you don't actually believe in it unless you believe that it's the disagreement, it's the conflict between different points of view that produces change and produces truth. So the theater immediately is positing a different idea of what truth is. But it's also doing more than that, because it's changing your relationship to it. Because when I turn here and start arguing with somebody there, you're not sitting back receiving anymore. You're leaning forward, metaphorically. You are doing the thing that we ask from you as theater practitioners. You are putting yourself in my shoes. And then you're putting yourself in somebody else's shoes. You're imagining what it feels like to be somebody other than you. You're trying on somebody else's point of view. And that act of empathy, which is absolutely essential to making drama work, is also absolutely essential to democracy. You can't make a democracy work if the citizens of that democracy aren't able to imagine what it looks like from somebody else's point of view. So this is, thesis, that democracy and theater develop together. It doesn't really matter which came first, but they develop together because the theater is actually the fundamental art form of democracy. That theater actually trains people to think democratically, or democracies train people to think theatrically, who cares? But that they are in symbiotic relationship to each other. Let me give you, we have some actually textual evidence, he says, speaking at a university. Because the first surviving play we have, Aeschylus's The Persians, is one of the very rare Greek tragedies that was not based on myth, but was actually a docudrama. It was about a war that had happened 8 years before during the second great Persian invasion of Greece. And that was led by Xerxes, Darius's son. Darius had led the first invasion. His son leads the second invasion in 480 BC. And the Persians are decisively defeated. This war, this victory over the Persians in 480, we were talking about the Civil War earlier tonight. This is like the Civil War, the Revolutionary War, and World War II all rolled up into one. This is the great victory of the Greek city-states. This is the victory that proves that Greeks are better than Persians, and it demonstrates that democracies are better than tyrannies. It demonstrates that free soldiers fight better than mercenaries. All of those things that absolutely affirm who Athens is, it affirms Athenian democracy, was in that battle and in that victory over the Persians. So 8 years later, Aeschylus, who fought in the Battle of Salamis, that was all that he had on his gravestone, was that he fought in the Battle of Salamis. 8 years later, Aeschylus writes a play about this from the Persian point of view. He writes about what this victory looked like from the Persian court. Now, 8 years. So imagine that we are now twice that many years away from 9/11. It is twice as distant from us as that battle was from Aeschylus and from his audience. And that means that battle involved everybody. Everybody in Athens lost a brother, a son, a father, a husband. There were wounded people in the audience. This was a totally, entirely society-involving thing. And Aeschylus asked them to sit there and imagine that victory over again from the Persian point of view. Now, to be fair, of course, to a certain extent, one can smell some schadenfreude in the play, and let's relive this, how badly they suffered. But he's too great a dramatist, and frankly, a play is too long. I mean, you can't sustain that. You can't sustain watching the entire play of the Persians without actually feeling sympathy for the loss. The central character, Queen Atossa, begins by waiting for news of the inevitable victory of her son to come back. And first comes the news that the fleet has been destroyed. Second scene, the ghost of her dead husband comes back and mourns with her what their son has lost. Of course, third scene, Xerxes himself comes back, having lost everything that his father had won. There's no way to read this without believing that Aeschylus is asking us to put ourselves in the Persian shoes. If I tried to put on a play like that about Osama bin Laden, my job would be in jeopardy. I'm not kidding. Twice as long ago. Aeschylus did this. But the other thing, if you read the play closely, that you can't help but see in there, is Aeschylus saying in that beautifully dramatic way to his audience, look who else was sure that they were better than their opponent. Look who else was certain that God was on their side. Look who else was certain that their empire would last for 1,000 years. And of course, from the time that Aeschylus presented this play to the fall of the Long Wall, as the war with the Spartans destroyed the Athenian democracy, was about 45 years. So prescient, or eerily prescient, Aeschylus' drag name. sorry. Sometimes I actually see myself in a suit lecturing, and I just can't quite believe it. So the other thing, there's only one other thing we know about the Persians, and it's a thing I delight in, because no reviews have survived. The reviews all died. They got lost to history. We have the play, but nobody remembers the critics. But the thing we do know is that it won no prizes that year. We have the list of who won the prizes. Nothing. So, not the most popular play. And yet, it was written down and transcribed and remembered and carried around so much that it's one of the 40-odd plays that survived the burning of the Library of Alexandria, the collapse of the classical world, and everything else that prevented hundreds and hundreds of plays from coming down to us. And it's one of the handful of Greek tragedies that survived, because it mattered enough to enough people that they kept it alive. And that's sort of a beautiful, it didn't win any prizes, but it really mattered. So this thesis, I mean, this is not that outrageous a thesis, it's not even that original a thesis. Theater flourishes at times of democratic enfranchisement, at democratic expansion. You can see it again with the Elizabethans. The peculiar thing that the Elizabethans had, the Tudor Compromise meant that not only was secular theater possible in Elizabethan England, it was actually legally required, because they were so worried about the conflict between the Catholics and the Protestants that religious subjects were banned from the stage. So for the first time, the theater had to come up with a secular entertainment, and those playhouses that were built meant for the first time since the Greeks, you had an audience sitting where all classes sat together. And Shakespeare was a really good poet. We have the sonnets to prove it. But I contend that what made him a great playwright was that audience. Because anybody who works in the theater knows that you've got that audience, you've got to speak to that audience. And he had an audience that included, as we know, the queen, the aristocracy, the Oxford and Cambridge graduates, the most literate and educated people in the kingdom, Ben Jonson snarking at him all the time. But it also included all those groundlings, most of whom would have been illiterate. And if you think for a second, you know, if we have some kind of, you know, image that the Elizabethan playhouse was like the Globe is now, with the polite tourists standing there shuffling a little weight,
You think those people sat there and just like, shh, I can't hear the rhyme. Those people needed to be entertained. Those people needed to be engaged in the story. So Shakespeare is forced to write a story that will speak to all of these people, and in the peculiar way that the theater does, because it's a time-based art, speak to all of them at the same time. Not just, you know, I can pick this from there, I can pick this, I stop and think about it and read back. You can't do that in theater. So you have to make everybody in the audience from all of those different classes follow you at the same time. I'm gonna jump in my story, because here's a beautiful illustration. I'm gonna talk a little bit later about the mobile theater that we do at the Public. And the mobile theater, which we revived 6 years ago, tours to prisons and homeless shelters and halfway houses to the most neglected and despised parts of society, and we do Shakespeare for them. We do cut versions of Shakespeare, admittedly. We do stripped down versions of Shakespeare because you can't take sets into the prisons. But they are beautiful productions that we then go to and run downtown for our audience. They're not some secondary outreach program. Very first time we did this, we were doing a production of Measure for Measure that was directed by a brilliant woman from Minneapolis, Michelle Hensley, who runs a theater called 10,000 Things. And if you have any serious interest in the theater, her book, All the Lights On, is required reading. So, Michelle directed this production of Measure for Measure that was just, it just sort of landed in the prisons in this extraordinary way, because it's all about justice and injustice and being falsely accused and being hypocritically punished. And in one scene, we were in the women's prison, which at that time was on the west side of Manhattan. Isabel, who is a nun, has come to plead for the life of her brother from Angelo, who is the temporary duke. Angelo, the temporary duke, has decided to strictly enforce the laws against any kind of sexual frippery. So he has condemned Isabel's brother Claudio to death for sleeping with his fiancée. And that's gonna be punished by death. So Isabel comes to plead for his life. She pleads very eloquently, so eloquently that our Duke develops an insane passion for her and announces that he will spare her brother's life if she will sleep with him. And of course, she refuses, dearer than my brother's life is my chastity. She refuses, and he goes off stage. It's a very serious problem, right? And Nicole Watson, who played Isabel for us, turns to the audience, and she just does Shakespeare's soliloquy. She says, "To whom should I complain?" And a woman in the audience immediately shouted out, "The police!" And you know, Nicole was a little taken aback. This was her first performance, but then, brilliant actress that she was, she just said the next line. "If I did report this, who would believe me?" And the woman said, "No one, girl." And of course, this is both a tremendously powerful human moment and a Shakespeare geeky delight, because you suddenly realize that's the way the soliloquies were written to be performed. That line didn't happen to come next. That line came next because that audience answered the question when it was asked. And you realize that's the quality of interaction that Shakespeare was able to generate with the audience. And when you think about that, that way he's becoming a great writer, because he is writing for everybody at once. What are the characteristics that we see there? Well, first of all, writing for everybody at once, all of his plays have this enormous social stratification in with them. There is no such thing as a private relationship in Shakespeare. Two people can't just fall in love with each other and then we follow what happens to their next date and their next date and then their relationship falls apart. When two people fall in love with each other, it involves their families. It involves their parents. It involves the prince of the kingdom. It involves the laws of the land. In other words, this private relationship is actually completely enmeshed in a whole set of social relations, all of which Shakespeare puts on stage with his company of about 18 actors. So it's true in every one of Shakespeare's plays. And you realize that that's actually serving two functions. One, it means that he's reflecting a great swath of society. But the other thing is he's also demonstrating that everybody is interconnected, that there's no such thing as a completely private life. And that's just as true of us, but we have a fiction, we have a culture, which is constantly telling us, it's just you and that girl, do you love each other enough? What are the difficulties? What about that third girl? You know, it constantly tries to privatize and make our lives smaller than they are. What Shakespeare realized is that our lives could only be understood when looking at all of us together at the same time. And why is he doing that on stage? Because that's what he's seeing out in the audience. He's seeing everybody there together at the same time. And he's doing more than just reflecting that. He's reflecting that back to the audience. And here's a little bit, my old friend and mentor, Robert Brustein, had this wonderful comparison I've never been able to get in my head. He said, here's the real difference between the movies and the theater. When you go to the movies, you're really hoping nobody else is there. You're really hoping. And now that they have stadium seats, you know, my brother and I can put our legs over the seats in front of us. You know, it's comfortable for big guys. You know, we can put our popcorn there and our Coke there and actually throw the coat over there. And then we sit down and there's the movie. And that's the best way to see a movie. If you walk into a theater that is two-thirds empty, your heart sinks, right? That you go, oh, shit. And now it's Bowdoin, I can say that, right? So part of that is simple, which is, you know, you think on the surface, oh, that just means that what does everybody else know that I don't know, that they're not here? But what it really means is you're disappointed because you have lost one of the important things you're looking for by going to the theater. You're looking for being part of an audience. That's what you actually want. That's the thrill of the theater. We all, right, all of us know that moment when everybody is laughing in a theater, you laugh harder than you laugh by yourself. That moment when everybody is dead quiet in the theater, isn't that fantastic? With the Delacorte in Central Park, we get 2,000 people in that theater, outdoors, in the summer, with raccoons running across the stage, and birds flying, and fire engines going, and helicopters pursuing people through the park. It's the one thing we can have no effect on is that when the police are in hot pursuit of somebody, they are allowed to interrupt Hamlet. So all of that going on, but still, we have the experience of the entire audience getting quiet at the same moment because they're so eager to hear what's happening next. Now, that's partly like, oh, great play. It makes me want to know what happens next. But what it's also doing is making everybody in that audience feel like one body, feel like you're all part of the same thing, being aware viscerally that you have more in common with one another than you have set different from one another. That, again, is a fundamental muscle that we need exercised in order to make our democracy work. It's the opposite of what is happening, and we all know this, with our information, where over the last, well, over your lifetimes, but over the last 20 years, we have grown increasingly siloed, increasingly in echo chambers, where we can live in not just opinions, but it started to be that we live in facts that are only shared by us and our friends. And as somebody once said, you know, that all the news media is saying all this stuff about Trump, why don't people get it? And somebody said, well, no, not all the news media, because for an awful lot of people, Twitter is their news media. That's where they're getting their news. So we have all sorts of forces in the culture that are trying to separate us out, make us listen to one side of the story, make us reinforce our own point of view, and so few that are taking a whole audience and making us say, no, we actually have more in common. That is, I'm hearing my mother's voice saying, you're talking too much, Oscar. But that is the reason, I think, that Hamilton has had the impact that it's had. Because the energy that it's unleashing in an audience is an energy from an audience that has not been allowed to be patriotic. And by watching Hamilton again, it lets progressive people who have been full of doubts about this country, it reminds them of the promise of this country. It reminds them of the better angels of this country. And it does it in the most earnest way imaginable. It's something actually not too many people talk about. There's a lot of things about Hamilton that are groundbreaking and new and original, but I have to tell you, I work in the American theater. One of the stunning things about it is utter absence of irony. It is a musical that wears its heart utterly on its sleeve, sometime to the point of almost embarrassment, but not quite embarrassment, because it's so truthful. It's so sincere in what it does. And the audience, we've just found, you know, to our shock, that this has an enormous effect on the audience, which then produces all sorts of other problems, like where I started with who gets in, who doesn't get in, and we can talk about that more later. But this is the basic point. I'm making the same point over and over, and you're hearing it. And we've seen it in six. I could run through other historical epics, that at times of historic democratic expansion, the theater does well. The theater is a democratic medium. So hang on, I'm sorry. I actually have to look at notes for a second. You're gonna forgive me, right? All right, because where I'm gonna jump now is to the theater in this country, which, and particularly the history of the nonprofit theater movement, which I know the best in the country. Is the subject I know the most about. And there'll be other things that we can talk about when we get to the Q&A, but I wanna stay on this for a few more minutes because it matters to me, I think. That after World War II, the field that I now belong to, the professional nonprofit theater, was essentially founded. And it was founded really by three women, Zelda Fitch Handler in Washington, D.C., Nina Vance in Houston, and Margot Jones in Dallas. And these three women each founded theaters, two of which still survive today, the Alley and the Arena Stage in Washington, which had an idea that in a certain way could be defined by some negatives. They were not commercial theaters. They were not designed to make money. They were not community theaters. They were not amateurs. They were professionals. And they were not university theaters, which was the other kind of theater that we knew at that time. And with those, they started to form an idea that really, I think, had two different roots in the post-war period. And the first was a democratic root, that in the post-war period, America's prosperity came back, recovered mostly by the war effort from the Depression. There was a huge economic upsurge, and there was a huge educational upsurge from something called the GI Bill, which some of you will remember. And the GI Bill was passed in 1944, and the idea was to reward the servicemen and women who had served in the Second World War by giving them credits towards education. This seemed like a really good idea. Nobody imagined what actually happened out of it. Half of the people who served in the Second World War took advantage of the GI Bill for educational purposes. Over 2.5 million went to college. And this was the moment when going to college started to become something that could be expected for a large range of America. Prosperity, education put together, and a democratic demand for the decentralization of culture. The idea that in a country like ours, that doesn't have one capital, but that's spread out over the 50 states, that culture shouldn't belong just to New York, and certainly not to Washington, but culture could belong all over the country, that we were a federation of states, and that in those states, local culture should spring up that would be our contribution to the world. That was the grassroots sensibility of where this movement came from. There was also another color to that, which is that the U.S. came out of the Second World War the most powerful nation in the world, and very soon the most powerful nation the world had ever seen. And there were many forces within the country who thought that, well, like Greece and Rome before us, we should have a culture that reflects the dominance that we have as an economic and military power. So you can even see in what I used to call the theaters with fountains in front of them, the Kennedy Center, Lincoln Center, the Music Center in Los Angeles, you can even see it's neo-Roman architecture. It's definitely designed to reflect that power. So both of those impulses came together to form this nonprofit theater movement. Again, I've spent my life in it. It's had extraordinary successes. It's had disappointments. But it has spread and grown, so it is actually a movement. It's a movement that now exists in every state of the union. There are over 400 theaters that are professional nonprofit theaters in the United States, and actually that number is probably closer to 800, but depending on how you count it, please don't fight with me about that because we waste a lot of time that way. It has succeeded. It's a field. It's a field that was seriously challenged starting in November of 1980. It was seriously challenged by a number of different things, and one is the National Endowment for the Arts was challenged. And two principles that held up the National Endowment for the Arts came under attack and were abandoned. And one of them was that the primary idea, the primary criteria for rewarding artists should be artistic excellence, and that that excellence should be judged by peer review. That panels of artists would come together, judge the quality of the work that was happening around the country, and award money on that basis. The NEA was never the prime funder for most of these theaters. Ford Foundation had that title. But the NEA and the Ford Foundation together were part of a nexus of national funding that came from New York and that came from Washington, that spread out over the country, that held out that there was a place for a democratic art that had nothing to do with the marketplace. And that that idea, art that had nothing to do with the marketplace, came under attack not only in the theater, but in the culture as a whole, starting about 1980, as the idea of the market became more and more valorized in our culture. And I'm gonna steal a couple of examples here from a friend of mine, Michael Sandel, who teaches at Harvard. And he has a wonderful book, What Money Can't Buy, another wonderful book called Justice, and these examples are taken from that book. Because what Michael says is that we have always had a market economy, but what has happened over the last 30 years is we've started to develop into a market society that believes that everything can have a dollar price tag put on it. Everything can be measured in dollars. And the examples he uses are of a daycare center that was having trouble because parents were picking their kids up late. They were showing up late. It was difficult for the staff. Some of the staff had to get home to their kids. And so the daycare center decided, you know what? We will institute a series of fines. And if you're late, it's going to be $10 for every half hour you're late. And what happened? The lateness immediately doubled. People began coming immediately, twice as many people began coming late because they were paying to come late. They didn't think of it as a fine. They thought of it as a fee for service. And let's take that, extend that even farther, as Michael does. Let's say that you're a contractor working on 157, that incredibly tall skyscraper condominiums that's gone up on 57th Street. Let's say there's a handicapped parking zone right in front of that. Well, we don't believe that non-handicapped people, non-disabled people, should park in handicapped parking zones, right? It's that's there because we as a society believe that disabled people should be able to park and be able to have the mobility that contemporary life requires. Well, let's say that, so we give them fines. Let's say it's a $500 fine that you get for parking in that space. And you know what, the police watch, you get a ticket every day. Nobody ever gets away with it. This contractor who's working on this $250 million building decides that's the price of doing business. He's gonna park there every day. He's gonna get the ticket, and so what? $500, he's working on a $250 million building, doesn't matter. Do we think that's ethical behavior? Not a rhetorical question, real question. No, why not? He's paying for it. Who deserves it? Right, so it was set up, so it's actually, it doesn't matter, if he was paying $2,000, we wouldn't want him to have it, right? If it was $10,000, we wouldn't want him to have it. We want that available for disabled persons, right? It's not a fee, it's a fine. It's there to try to stop antisocial behavior because there are things that we believe in as a society that can't be measured by the money. And the problem is when you put money on it, suddenly, you're removing the moral basis of it, and you're saying, just by paying the, and of course, as the wealth increasingly disperses on a society, this becomes a realer and realer problem, because there come huge numbers of people for whom money is not a question at all. And believe me, as a guy who sells tickets to Hamilton, I know that there's a lot of people for whom money is not an issue at all. But all of this is a way of saying that our culture has gotten very weak on the idea of values that can't be measured in dollars, on values that have nothing to do with the marketplace. I'll give you another example. And I am coming close to the end for those of you who are worried. I run Free Shakespeare in the Park, right? I inherited it, I didn't invent it. It's one of the great beauties of New York City. It's free, it's been free for 60 years. People have been coming, and not just some people. We get 2,000 seats there, and every night, 1,500 of them are for people who have waited in line or entered the lottery and pay nothing for it. So I arrive at the Public Theater 12 years ago, and I propose to my board of directors that we should try and make all the tickets downtown free as well, because this is such the right principle. To a person, the board of directors tells me this is a bad idea. And it's not because we can't afford it. It's actually, you know, it's hard, but we can figure out a way to afford it. It's because it won't work because people don't value something that they don't pay for. This is the board of directors of the Public Theater. So what I was seeing that moment, and I've now spent the last decade talking about to them, and they're very different now, is that the ideology that you can only measure the value of something by charging for it was so powerful that it overrode their own experience of half a century of giving away tickets in Central Park to the most rabid, enthusiastic audience at any theater in the country, I dare say, certainly at any theater in New York. That's what they were doing every day. But they were sure that people wouldn't value something that they didn't pay for. It's a powerful idea, and it's an idea that has to be struggled with and fought. Now, how am I going to tie all of this together? Because I've been talking about different things. I'm going to try, and then you're going to tell me whether I succeed or not. Because this is the challenge I think we're facing. We're facing a society that puts a dollar price on everything or wants to. We're facing a society that's siloed and that only speaks to itself. And we're facing in which different groups only speak to itself. And we've got a society where the culture, we ourselves, are being reserved, we are serving only part of society. And I'm not simply referring to the racial and economic diversity issues, which we all take very seriously and deal with, but I'm referring to the geographic ones as well. So there's three things I want to talk about that the public does. I'm going to talk about two of them, and then I'm going to show you a really pretty short video. It'll sell the third one better than I can. And the first one I've already discussed, which is the mobile unit. We revived the mobile unit 5 years ago. The mobile unit goes to, again, prisons, homeless shelters, halfway houses, parks. The entire criteria of the mobile unit is to go to people who otherwise don't have access. And we found out we did it because, look, Shakespeare in the Park, it's great, right? It's wonderful, everything about it is great, except there's a contradiction buried in it, and it's not even buried, you've probably already seen it, which is it was formed to give access to Shakespeare to everybody. And now, next to Hamilton, it's the hardest ticket to get in New York City. We eliminated the economic barrier, but exactly what percentage of the population do you think can seriously consider waiting in line from 6 a.m. till 2 p.m. in the middle of Manhattan in order to see a Shakespeare play that night? You have already dripped it down to maybe 1% of the population can even consider doing that, which is part of the reason our audience is so young, because many of them are students, they can consider it. So the ticket that was created, the theater that was created in order to provide access is now unbelievably exclusive. So we revived the mobile in an attempt to just literally go to where the people are. It's been a huge success in a number of ways. First of all, nobody at my theater wants to work on anything else now. It is funner to work on the mobile than anything else I do. The demand is off the charts. We could be running 3 companies of the mobile unit year-round, and we wouldn't be able to go to every place that wants us to go to. It's been hugely popular with the audiences. And it's also, we have now done the metrics, because there is a place for metrics. We did a huge sweep of all of the different programs the public does last year for finding out who our audience is. And what we discovered was that our audience is more diverse than most theaters in Central Park and even downtown, but not by as much as we thought it was. It's, you know, instead of being 80% Caucasian, it's 69% Caucasian. You know, I mean, that's a little disappointing when you're the Public Theater. There's exactly one program where the composition of the audience reflected exactly the citizenry of New York City, and that was the mobile unit. And it's just at that point, that's a good use of metrics, right? As Nate Silver would say, good use of metrics. Because at that point you're saying, we've just proved that if we want an audience that we say we want, if we want a completely diverse economically and racially, ethnically audience, we just have to go to where they are. We have to go to them and not expect them to come to us. So the mobile unit, it's been a great success for us. We are doubling down on it. Over the next few years, we have big plans and we'll increase it more. But I'm going to say one thing. Don't talk to the press about this. If there's anybody from the press here, this is off the record, because I haven't got the permission to do this yet. But I just got the money yesterday. Sweat, which is the show we just opened on Broadway, which is this brilliant play about the deindustrialization of Reading, Pennsylvania. Lynn Nottage, the playwright, spent years getting to know the people in Reading. It is just torn from the headlines, and it is about the way class intersects with race. It is the best depiction of the white rage that was visible on November 8th of anything that I've seen in the culture. It's just gotten wonderful reviews on Broadway. The day after we closed it downtown at the Public Theater, we took it to Reading, Pennsylvania. And when I say took it, we did a mobile unit version of Sweat, which has sound and lights and sets and costumes and everything that a play normally does. We just put the actors in a van, drove them to Reading, Pennsylvania, went into the Civic Auditorium, which is kind of like this, but a lot older and not as nice. And we did the play with no sets, no props, no costumes, no lights, a boombox, you know, with some sound cues, and, you know, those cubes that I hope you're not using in your acting classes, you know, but I did, you know, those cubes, that's all we had. And we did it for an audience packed, 850 people, and 250 people in the lobby listening to on the monitor. And it was like a religious revival, because Lynn had not gotten to know these people, and what we were performing was them for them. And it was spectacular. So, once I get permission, there's commercial considerations, which I'll get those, get those done. We're planning a tour for a mobile unit version of Sweat through Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, and Wisconsin. And the starting point of the tour is we're taking every county that went for Obama in 12 and Trump in 16, and we're saying we will perform in that county by hook or crook. Now, it's a huge enterprise. We're going to fall all over ourselves. We're going to make a lot of mistakes. But the basic idea is simply, you know what? We can't afford to have a mission that is just New York City, because you know what that is? That's a blue mission. That's what New York City is. If we're actually going to be seriously doing what we say, we have to have a national mission. And that blessed board, who I was just bad-mouthing, have completely gotten behind this and said, yes, the Public Theater can now say it has a national mission, and let's go and make this happen. And of course, there's a lot of complications. I'm looking at Sarah. It's not enough to just like perform for them, because that's kind of colonial, right? But we're also going to talk to them. We're going to do workshops. We're going to start a dialogue, start something, then come back the next year with Shakespeare. So that principle of the mobile unit, I think, is terribly, terribly important, and I really believe in it. Here's another subject that I think we have to do something about that is separate from that, which is, in a way, almost the opposite of that. It's payment for artists. Because this great movement that I was talking about, the nonprofit theater, which is spread out across the country, which has literally tens of thousands of people who now make middle-class livings, sometimes lower middle class, but real livings from the American nonprofit theater, they're not artists. The development directors, the press reps, the artistic directors, the executive directors, even the technicians make a living. The artists don't. What we pay artists in my field is a disgrace. It's a shanda, as my people would say. Are you agreeing?
Yes.
Oh, thank God. If you were disagreeing, I'd be upset. It's just wrong. And it's also, it's one of the ways that society works. The whole field knows this is happening, and just everybody has just washed their hands. Nobody ever decided that artists weren't going to make a living from the theater. We just sort of let it happen as a collective, and we sort of sidestep to the left. And suddenly you've got a situation where really what we're saying to actors, for example, is, you know, you're going to make your living in television, in film, in voiceovers, in video games, in all those new media that I don't understand. That's where you're going to make money. And, you know, when you're young and when you can't get other work and when you're slumming, come back to us. And we'll. That's not a recipe for a great and vibrant theater. That's a recipe for a hobby theater. So we have to figure out how we pay people fairly. And we are doing a lot of work on that and running into some resistance from our colleagues. But I think it's an important thing to do. All right, so I've really spoken a long time. So I'm going to come to an end by talking finally about the program I'm most excited about. And there's Seth. I know you've seen every one of these, Seth. This is the Public Works Program, and I'm going to play a very short video to give you an introduction to the Public Works Program. Or rather, I'm not going to play it. Somebody, you're going to push that button, and it's going to start. Thank you.
We're living in a moment in history when our communities are increasingly divided from each other. The city of New York, while in many ways the most diverse and vibrant city, also struggles with real internal division. And I think that that's bigger than just the city. I think it's a bigger cultural issue. The chance to actually be with other human beings making something together, it just bursts through all of those divisions. With Public Works, when we come to the room, we come as equals, and I'm really restored to a sense of what it would feel like to be part of a unified city. Works is an initiative to create ambitious participatory theater in collaboration with partner organizations in the five boroughs. The idea animating Public Works is this idea that theater belongs to everyone, that the culture belongs to everyone, and that in order to realize that beautiful democratic and civic idea, really we need to move towards a model of fully participatory theater.
We believe that theater has a specific role to play. It always has. It's a democratizing impulse. It's an empowering impulse. It's a participatory impulse. And what we're trying to do really is to spread the glory of that so that everybody in the city has the chance to have that experience.
It's so liberating that you have the old, the young, the in-between working together in a space. I mean, how big could this be? It's a wonder. It's truly a wonder.
It's such a euphoric feeling to be with a group of people that are letting us experiment and see how far we can go. And I'm just like so happy that I was a part of this because it's really great.
To be a part of this, is for me, it's like history. This is big. I didn't vision it, and then once it came together, it was like, wow. I mean, 200 people on stage singing and clapping and dancing. It's fantastic.
We are now in year two of Public Works. We have resumed our activities in the borough locations, doing classes, readings, workshops, attending shows together, talking about those shows, building toward this production at the Delacorte in Central Park.
This is a big change for my life. All I knew is how to do negative things. This is something positive here. I'm quite sure people that come here and they say, wow, if they can do it, maybe I can do it. Maybe we can change this world.
It's beautiful to really get out there and to perform in front of people and working with a family that just give you that push. I mean, it's beautiful. I love it. And I can't wait for tonight to really get out there and perform.
This is our proposal to humanity, and I was struck by that. I was like, well, let's do it then. I've seen people transform their lives as I have. I've seen myself transform as well.
The power of theater is unleashed when people are not only watching it, but participating in it. If we can do that in a deep enough way, we turn it from being something that you purchase, consume, or just watch into something that is actually a set of relationships. And if we can make that theater vivifying our relationships as a city, we'll have a better city. thank you. So let me just say a word or two about Public Works, because it's the thing that, honestly, I'm most excited about. Lyra de Bessonnet, who you saw in there, is really a genius. She's an inspirational leader. And she had been doing community work, and we began a series of conversations that led to the creation of Public Works. Over the course of a year, she met with and researched 70 different community-based organizations in the five boroughs, picked five, one in each borough. The Brownsville Recreation Center in the poorest neighborhood of Brooklyn, the Children's Aid Society, the Fortune Society, which is a fantastic organization that's dedicated to rehabilitating prisoners back into society when they're released, Dream Yard in the Bronx, which is a gorgeous youth arts facility, and Domestic Workers United. You saw Christine Lewis from the Caribbean, who's the president, which is the Union of Domestic Workers. And we picked these five organizations both for their geographic diversity and all other kinds of diversity. And the Lear's genius was that what she did was go to those organizations and say, we're the public theater, here's a bunch of information about us. What do you want us to do for you? What would you like? And it wasn't us saying, here's a program. It's saying, how could we help? So my favorite examples are the seniors at the Brownsville Recreation Society decided the thing they wanted from us was a dance class. And so we did a dance class once a week, every week, which by about the fifth month, they started to get interested in maybe we could do a little scenes with the dance. And it started to transform into something else. Domestic Workers United decided what they wanted was a classical play reading group in English and in Spanish, because that was the one thing nobody ever valued them for their minds. So we host a classical play reading group at the public twice a month, year round. So on the basis of that relationship, and of course we give everybody free tickets to the shows, and we bring in the shows, and Lear started potlucks at the theater where all of the different communities started coming and bringing food, and we had potlucks once a month at the theater, which is a continuing thing. So by the time we get to the idea of this show, of doing the show, we have a deep and embedded set of relationships with these community, these members of the community. We create these 90-minute musical Shakespearean pageants that include five equity actors, and they're usually the best actors the city has to offer, Tony Award winners, amazing people, five professional musicians, and from 200 to 250 members of the community performing. They audition, we cast them, we rehearse all summer, and we go up over Labor Day weekend. And I think, Seth, you'll bear me out, right? Amazing. Just so the Tempest was the first year 5 years ago, and it was only three nights then. It's up to five now. But, you know, and that was the Delacorte, by the way. That's my beautiful theater. So first night of the Tempest, I go, and listen, by this point, I knew the project was a success in the sense of it's really the people doing it had a great time. It was good for them. We had an embedded anthropologist who was showing all the ways that everything had improved about their lives, from their ability to take responsibility for themselves to staying out of the penal system, everything. But what I had no idea is the effect it would have on an audience. And I sat there that first night of the Tempest, and I went, this is actually the best art I've seen in the theater all year. This is extraordinary. And I canceled my plans for the next night, and I've never missed a performance of Public Works since. It's my favorite thing of the year. And the reason that I think it's unleashing energy is exactly what I'd say in somewhat pretentious form there, which is that it's taking something that's frozen, the idea that up here on stage we are an art object, we are stars, we are celebrities, and out there you're in the audience receiving us. And it breaks that paradigm. And it actually says, you know, the difference in who's in the audience and who's on stage is not a binary difference. It's just a gradation difference. It's just what you happen to be doing today. And the difference between that guy who's just out of 20 years in prison and is delivering this just heart-stopping version of Gonzago's speech in The Tempest, the difference between him and Norm Lewis, who's won two Tonys, is not a binary difference. It's not that Norm's a professional and he's not. It's that Norm has spent a lot more time. He put in his 10,000 hours. He's spent a lot more time practicing. He's got maybe some more natural gifts. And, you know, it's possible that Philip doesn't have as many natural gifts. He certainly hasn't had much opportunity to do it. But it's just, we're just at different places on the grade. It's not different positions. And that unleashes an energy that is my favorite thing in the theater. Where is it going to lead? I don't know. That's That's what I meant. What is it? That's as analog as it gets, right? I mean, there's just totally. So I don't know how digital this. I don't know how, but I know there's. So these are the ways that we're working to try to essentially unleash the democratic power of the theater in all of the ways that we possibly can. And I think that's probably the best that I have to offer you tonight. So that's what I had to say. Thank you. We're going to put up microphones, I think, in the aisle. Thank you very much. If anybody can stand to hear any more talking, please just happy to take questions. Or we can sit in meditative silence for a minute and go in greener pastures. Okay.
I enjoyed your talk tremendously, but
thank you.
You avoided two words, and I was wondering why you avoided those two words, and could you talk to those two words, and they are Joe Papp.
Sir, in my 12 years at the Public Theater, this is maybe the first time I've been accused of avoiding Joe Papp. I worship Joe. Joe founded the Public Theater. Joe was an extraordinary man. As I explained at dinner, Joe, the only time I really had an interaction with Joe is I auditioned for him when I was 17, and I walked out of the audition room and gave up acting, which is true. But let me tell, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to tell a story about Joe Papp, because this is a good one. Here's the founding legend of the Public Theater, but it's a true story, which is Joe, who never went to college, was a member of the Communist Party, was pretending not to be a Jew, even though he was a Jew, grew up in a Yiddish-speaking household in Flatbush, came out of the Navy, you know, he actually directed a musical with Bob Fosse in it, in the Navy. you know, what a music, what I would give to go back and see that. So he starts this Shakespeare workshop, and he starts immediately, he casts people of all colors because that's the people he knows, and that's, you know, it's also his belief system. And he starts doing free Shakespeare in the Park. It's a completely amateur thing. There's no money involved for anybody. You know, they're just, he's got a day job as a stage manager for CBS television. And he does about 3 years of Shakespeare in the Park, and my God, it's really successful. I mean, partly because he happens to stumble on Roscoe Lee Brown and George C. Scott and Colleen Dewhurst. Not bad for stumbling on some actors. So, you know, it's going really well. And then Robert Moses, the all-powerful, you know, to say he's the commissioner of the parks doesn't begin to do justice to Bob Moses, the most powerful man in the history of New York City, also chairman of the Triborough Bridge Authority. That doesn't really fill you with awe, does it? But it should. Nothing happened in New York that Robert Moses didn't make happen. Mayors tried to fire him and went down in flames. He's the architect of much of what is New York City today. And he decided that Joe Papp could not do free Shakespeare in the Park anymore, that Joe needed to charge for it. And what he said was he needed to charge for it and split it with the Parks Department so that, because the people were sitting on the grass and they were making patches in the grass and they needed money to reseed the grass. Those of us who know a little bit more about Robert Moses and who he liked and who he didn't like don't really believe that was the reason. He wanted to keep a certain class of people out of the park who were attracted by the free admission. But in any case, Joe said no. Joe said to charge for even a nickel would violate the principle that this is for everybody, this belongs to everybody. So he gets in a fight, this 30-year-old stage manager for CBS television gets in a fight with the most powerful man in New York City, and it ends up on the front page of the New York Times. 6 times in 4 months. It becomes this huge cause celeb. It's not a coincidence that at the same time Jane Jacobs is quietly organizing the Mothers of Washington Square downtown to stop him from putting Fifth Avenue right through Washington Square Park. But nobody knows that right now. All attention is on Joe. And actually there's a campaign that thousands of packets of grass seed are sent to Robert Moses' office. So he received huge. So Moses gets really pissed off, and we have some of the video of this, which is just shocking. And Moses just ranting on television. And what he does is red bait Joe. And he says that this is a typical communist thing that Joe is doing, and only because he's a member of the party would he do something like this. Whereupon, he gets called before the House Un-American, Joe, gets called before the House Un-American Activities Committee, takes the Fifth Amendment, and CBS television fires him. So now he's an unemployed 30-year-old television stage manager, who is fighting the most powerful man in New York City, and has filed suit against CBS to get his job back. It's kind of a stunning story. Well, end part of the story is that the appellate court in New York rules that Robert Moses has behaved in an arbitrary and capricious manner and forces him to allow Joe to do free Shakespeare in the Park. At the same time, the courts force CBS to give him his job back, and he immediately quits and never works for anybody else again. But, you know, it's a huge moment because it's actually the beginning of the end of Moses' domination of the city, and it's also one of the markers of the end of McCarthyism. That's Joe Papp. I hope you don't think I'm avoiding him anymore. I love him.
having had the good fortune of raising a family in Providence and seeing Adrian Hall and your own career and after your career, can you talk a little bit about repertory theater? And I've seen three generations of actors and actresses grow, and if you didn't like the play, at least you could appreciate the acting, et cetera.
You know, you're speaking to something very close to my heart, and it's actually very complicated. Trinity Rep, this extraordinary theater in Providence, Rhode Island, that I was lucky enough to inherit, it's the first of the two great theaters that I inherited from its founder, Adrian Hall, has its glory is an acting company that has been with it from the beginning of the theater. And it is a permanent acting ensemble, and all of the other acting companies in the country seem to have vanished. Not at Trinity. They've kept faith with that all these years. And what has grown up between that audience and that company, that theater, is like nothing I've ever experienced anywhere. You know, when I left Providence, I knew that I was giving up something I would never have again, which is running a theater that felt like it was right at the heart of the community of Rhode Island. When I was auditioning, interviewing for the job at Trinity Rep, I was living in LA, and I'd fly into Providence Airport, and I'd get in a taxi cab, and the driver would say, "What are you doing here?" And I'd say, "Well, you know, I'm talking about taking over this theater." They go, "Oh my God, I hate Barbara Meek. When are you going to get rid of her?" And it was every cab driver had been to the theater. It was just, I'd never seen anything like it. And, you know, I could say a lot more about this, but that particular thing where the life of the theater and the continuity of the theater is embodied in the actors who, you know, grow up, live, and die as part of the Trinity Rep Ensemble, is a beautiful and unique thing that has allowed that theater to survive. You know, Rhode Island's economy has been pretty bad a lot of the time, and that theater keeps pulling through. It's completely outsized. There's a state of 800,000 people has no business having a theater that big. And the reason it does is the lines of connection between that audience and that. And we've given up acting companies, and it's part of exactly what I was saying before about the way we don't support actors. We don't think we're responsible for the lives of actors. And in Providence, they've bucked that, and they've created something incredibly valuable as a result. All right, guys, really, we've talked enough, right? Listen, thank you very much for having me here. I greatly appreciate it, and I look forward to more to come. Thanks. Thank you.